You know about that Arctic air mass that was supposed to descend on the West Coast? Well, it has descended. Some places got down to 21 degrees, I hear, last night. And here it was 26.5. Very cold. It's very cold right now. I'm out here in the shadows outside. It's kind of like the, they say it never gets, you know, that cold in California. It's all sunny. Oh, sometimes it does. And just like the 500-year arc storm, which the whole Central Valley, it just floods. Disastrous. That happens too every so often, 500 years. Just like the big earthquakes happen occasionally. 1906, the last really big one. It's going to happen again soon. So the history of this planet is actually catastrophic. But there's no catastrophe greater than the one that's going to take place after the inauguration on January 21st. And that is called the Big Push Forward. The Big Push Forward, that is absolutely catastrophic for the world. It's going to be catastrophic because it's really a push forward into death. And this needs to be explained. You're going forward into death. You're changing the staging of the world to make it extremely full of death. Shakespeare said, all the world's a stage, and we are mere but players on the stage. Actually, we are but stagehands upon the stage. All the world's a stage, and we're merely stagehands. We are reconfiguring the stage, constantly reconfiguring it. Why? We are waiting for the hero to show up upon the stage. We are still waiting. Who is the hero we're waiting for? The hero is the non-self, the unreal self. The nothing self, which is actually nothing at all. We're waiting for that hero to show up. Why? What is the purpose that we are waiting? What is the hero going to do? What's the purpose of the play? The purpose of the play is for this non-self hero to discover nothing, to find nothing. And in the discovery of nothing, that will prove that this hero is greater than God. And this will supposedly make the hero real and be greater than God, because it is found nothing. So we are waiting for that to happen. And as we waited so long, it hasn't happened yet. Now, instead of saying, well, maybe it's impossible, maybe it's futile, maybe this is all just a hypothetical scenario, a contingency plan in case reality were destroyed, maybe this all derives from our desire to be prime creator, instead of considering these answers to our waiting, why hasn't happened, instead of that, most people look for a better leader, a better stagehand leader, and say, our problem is not because it's impossible or futile. Our problem is we haven't had the right direction yet, right leadership, to get the stage right. You see, we feel that the hero is not showing up on stage because the stage isn't appropriate. We must make an appropriate stage for the hero that must be worthy of this great hero. So what we look for is a great leadership and confidence and success to push us forward. Let's go forward, meaning let's change the staging. Let's get the staging right. Let's get the stage. The leader says, you know what, folks? The reason why we haven't succeeded is because we haven't got the stage right. And the folks back there, they didn't get the stage right. But we know better. We can get the stage right. We're going to get the staging right. So this time, let's get everybody on the same page. And those people who don't want it, let's get rid of them. Let's everybody get the staging right, because that is going to succeed, and we're very confident of success. That's what you get. But there are also those who say, hey, wait a minute, folks. What you're waiting for the impossible to happen. It'll never happen. There won't ever be nothing upon the stage, finding nothing. The play will never take place. There is no play that's ever going to take place. You are simply toiling in futility with changing the staging. Now, what? Nothing isn't there. There's nothing there at all. So how do you symbolize nothing? In order to even conceptualize it, you have to symbolize it. How is nothing symbolized? Death. Death symbolizes nothing. The end of life. In other words, nothing more after that. Nothing. So how do we make the stage more conducive to nothing showing up? You have to make this more death on the staging. The staging has to be very death-oriented to even give a feeling of success. You see, we'll say, well, I think it's going to be successful, but how? Symbolize death more. In fact, make it very intense. And then people say, hey, we're kind of confident this is going to work. Will it work? Of course not. Of course not. It's all symbolic. There will never be any play on the staging that we've toiled so long and hard on. Now, What is the remedy? Because there are those who know the remedy for sure. I've been mentored by those who know the remedy. We have a situation here where we've worked so hard on all the staging and we have sort of a feeling of affection for all the staging because it's something that we have done for so long. Now, God the Prime Creator knows this. God the Prime Creator also knows that the staging is useless as far as the purpose we have given it. Useless. No play will ever show up on that stage. Nothing will never show up and find nothing on that stage. So we have all the staging and it's useless to us. Utterly useless. So what do? Well, God in perfect wisdom said, listen, this is what we do. The Prime Creator created what's called the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit's purpose is to bless existence, is to bless all of it seamlessly. That's a different perception, is to give a different perception of all the staging. So right now, we have all the staging, and we're trying to make it conducive to nothing showing up. How do we do that? Death, fragmentation, all the things that are opposite to reality, fragmentation, impermanence, death, sickness, fear, all the stuff is all part of the staging. Everything here is decaying, rotting, dying. Everything that's born is born to die. All of this to try and get nothing to show up. And this does not remind us of reality at all. The problem we have is one of continuity is we get a sense that reality is something very different than what we're seeing. And there's such a break in continuity, we feel we can't go back to reality. So God said, no problem. The staging is useless to you for the purpose that you've given it, totally useless, and yet you don't want to set it down. And it doesn't remind you of reality, so you have a lot of problems. A lot of problems. But there's one easy solution to all your problems, the three major problems that you have. It doesn't remind you of reality. You have a fear of continuity, and you have affection for what you've done. Those are the three major problems. Affection for what there's all the work you've done in the state, building the stage. Fear of lack of continuity to going back to reality. It's cold. And what's the other one? You can tell me. anyway, it'll come up. And it doesn't remind you. And it doesn't remind you of reality at all. It doesn't remind you of reality. You have a fear of lack of continuity and affection for it. So God says there's one easy solution to all three of those problems. Change your perception of all the staging so that it reminds you of reality. A seamless beauty. So one, you keep all the staging that you've worked on is still there. So your affection for everything that I have, you still have it all. So that's not a problem. Two, it's seamless beauty, which reminds you of reality. This is very much like reality. And three, being reminded of reality and having affection for what you've worked on gives you a sense of continuity back to reality. So all three of those problems are properly dealt with by accepting a changed perception of all the staging. Literally, as you look out in the world, all the staging serves no purpose at all. None. It's only staging, and we're only stagehands. We're part of the staging too. We're both stagehands and part of the staging. Uh-oh. Is this still going? Let me see. Okay. We're stagehands, and stagehands too are part of the staging. So what we can do is accept the blessing of existence. Blessing upon, I call it the overlay. The overlay. Bliss, and all of the staging is equally beautiful. There's no differentiation, there's no separation. It's seamless, which reminds you of reality. All one whole seamless beauty. Not beauty here and then ugliness over there and more beauty here and less beauty here. All seamlessly beautiful. Perfect. You'd see everything seems completely flawless, absolutely flawless. That's a changed perception of existence. Now, is that a dream? Yes, it is. Just like all the staging is a dream. Is it a hypothetical? Yes, it is. Just like all this is hypothetical. It's a hypothetical that replaces a hypothetical. Is the world really beautiful? Is the staging really beautiful? It's really nothing at all. It's really nothing but a hypothetical. So the issue, is it really beautiful or not, is not in play at all. The only question is it useful? Is it useful? Is it helpful? Can it be helpful? Is seeing the beauty, seamless beauty of existence, is that helpful to reconcile us back to reality, to provide continuity back to reality? So we have continuity, we have familiarity, and we have remembrance, and we still have a feeling of affection for what we've worked on, all that. It's all there. That's only the question. Is it pragmatic? Is it an expedient? Is it useful? It's not a question of is it real, because a hypothetical is never real. So even a beautiful hypothetical is not real. So enlightenment, this vision, doesn't give you reality. It gives you a way to remember reality, a way to have continuity, to drop all hypotheticals, and a way to still have a feeling of affection for your creations, even though existence is not a creation, it's a hypothetical. You do have creations in reality, and you want to return to awareness of your creations and let them know that how much you love them. So it wouldn't do to just throw this existence in the toilet bowl and flush it or down the garbage disposal. No, that's not the way. That's not the way that God has given us. Given a blessing upon existence. But it, of course, it's not real. It's a dream. It's still a dream, which means it's okay. You can accept it. It's not a heavy thing. It's like, wow, I'm in reality now. No, it's not reality. Again, people ask you, well, you're just dreaming. Yes. If you accept that, yes, you are dreaming. But you're dreaming a happy dream. You're dreaming a practical, useful, effective dream. Whereas everyone else is also dreaming too. Existence is a dream. It's a hypothetical. So that people can say, well, you accept this. Well, that's just a hypothetical. Yes, it is. But all of this too is just a hypothetical. Existence that you're seeing now is also just a hypothetical. So the question is the hypothetical truly useful? And waiting for nothing to show up is not useful. It's a waste of time. Meaningless. It's completely meaningless. So you exchange a meaningless dream for one that reminds you of meaning. That's what you do. This program's a little buggy right now. There you go. Hopefully it's still recording. It's freezing up here. Maybe because it's so darn cold outside. I'm trying not to freeze up. So this is not, we're not impractical. We're not talking about impractical dream. The impractical dream is existence. The practical dream is bliss. Bliss is the practical dream. And so since it's all, we're not attacking dreaming. We're not saying dreaming, you know, stop dreaming. We're saying dream a happy dream. So we're not against trying to deprive someone of their dream. No, just give a different purpose to dreaming. In other words, different purpose to the hypothetical, to hypothesizing. What if? Hypothesis means what if this could happen? What if this were true? Not that it's that happened or true, but what if? That's a hypothetical. So seeing it this way makes it so much easier, so much easier. You don't have to kill the ego or get rid of the mind, all this stuff. Forget about that. Forget it. That's not it. Stay with your dreaming. Dream a happy dream. Stay with your hypothetical. Exchange hypotheticals for a happy hypothetical. A practical hypothetical. A useful hypothetical. What we have existence right now is useless. Totally useless. The purpose we've given to it is totally useless. We have made existence as a stage upon which this play, this hypothetical play of what if reality were destroyed, how could we survive it? Well, we have a nothing self finding nothing and becoming real and becoming, in other words, greater than the prime creator could even survive the annihilation and destruction of reality. There's something that can survive it, and this something is we call nothing. It's crazy, isn't it? Of course, if you annihilated reality, there'd be nothing. But we say, yeah, but nothing can find nothing. And from that finding of nothing, it can become real. This is simply a whimsical, hypothetical play of whimsical plausibility, really. And we've used our creativity to build a stage. And also we build conceptual stages and hypothetical, plausible stages and all this stuff that we've built up. We think, yeah, maybe it could happen, and we're waiting for it to happen. Now, we're tired of waiting. We're tired of waiting. Everyone's tired of waiting. So we're going to go in one, two directions. Either we're going to make the big push forward to change the staging, or we're going to make the big push to exchange hypotheticals. That's the time we live in now. The time we live in is a time of extremism, a time of activism. And you cannot avoid the times you live in, really. But you can choose what form of activism, what form of extremism you choose. You can choose. Is it to go forward and change the staging? Or is it to change your perception of the staging? All right. There won't be any middle ground where you say, well, let's do both. What does that mean? Let's do both. That's the trap that people fall into and causes mental problems, very bad depressions, etc. And I've talked about that at length many, many times. Obviously, if you're frantically working on changing the staging, how can you at the same time realize you don't need to do any change of the staging at all and do nothing at all with the staging? Just change your perception of it. If you change your perception of the staging, you realize you don't have to do anything at all. Ever again. You're completely free of ever needing to change the staging, because no matter what happens, it's all the same. You still see utter, perfect, flawless perfection, no matter what. So how can you see you don't need to do any change in the staging at all, and at the same time, frantic work on changing the staging as much hoping that is going to be the answer? Totally two completely mutually exclusive positions as far as dedication goes. So the idea of having both of these will put you into a state of extreme mental agitation and confusion. And that's what happens when you don't have strong advocates for changing your perception. That's what happens, because the overwhelming tendency in existence is to change the staging. Overwhelming. But occasionally there are those who come in the world and say, change your perception of the staging, which is God's plan of salvation. So when you're in this world, you almost certainly will try to accommodate the changing the staging of this world perspective. You will most certainly have to feel like you have to accommodate that. And then you say, well, I also want to change my perception too, so how can I accommodate both of them? You cannot. You try to accommodate both of them, you'll feel like you're stuck in the mud going nowhere. And the problem is we don't have enough of those in the world who have changed their perception of the world. We have, occasionally there are some, and I wish they were stronger advocates of this, because it's a severe problem that we try to accommodate both. And that really gives us the mental problems. It gives us the severe depression. The people who are working on changing the staging are not depressed. They're active. They're very active. You know, they're head knockers. They say, come on, let's remodel the whole thing, all the staging. Let's just do it. They're not depressed. They're super active. Now, those who say, let's accommodate both, they get depressed. They get mental problems, emotional, they get severe problems. So, and that could be lessened if there are those in the world who have changed their perception of the staging, simply changed their perception, accept the blessing of the Holy Spirit upon all of existence, and are experiencing this flawless beauty, which is a reminder of reality. That would actually greatly lessen the mental problems of the world, because people would say, I don't have to accommodate both. The accommodation of both is what's causing all my problems. And the answer is not some medication, some pharmaceutical medication. That's not the answer. The answer is to find those who have accepted the changed perception of the staging and to be reassured by them and then go in that direction. That is the answer, literally the answer. So we've made a strong push here this morning, and we can continue on. Let's take a slight breather here as I look for something. Okay, let me tone down the tone that down a little bit. The sun is starting to hit here. And we can take a little breather because we've been going full blast. We need to go full blast right now. And I'm doing that as much as possible because it's a super critical time. We've reached critical mass. We're going to reach critical mass in the inauguration. It's critical mass. Now it's hard to get the right lighting at this point. Okay. Well, it's not going, the right lighting. The staging is not going to work, is it? That's okay. Critical mass is coming soon. Very soon. Critical mass means that at some point the collective consciousness of this planet will crystallize into a feeling like this is it, and it has to happen now, and you're either with me or against me type of situation. And the pressure will become extreme. I've been beating this drum for several years now that I said that there's going to be a pressure, an extreme pressure coming up to conform to this plan of changing the staging. The idea that, well, the only reason we haven't succeeded, the staging, it hasn't been right. And the people in the past, they got it wrong, but we know better and we're going to fix, to get the staging just right. That's going to come. And it's going to come very, very soon now. It is going to be an extraordinary problem because those who may be on the spiritual path may feel pulled into trying to accommodate this. And in trying to accommodate it, they're going to get into this inner conflict. And inner conflict leads to agitation of the mind that leads to being burned out, it leads to depression, and ultimately it leads to the mind feeling very chaotic, very extremely chaotic. When you try to accommodate mutual exclusives, your mind ends up being chaotic. And that's a very, very bad place to be. I've been there. I know exactly what that's all about. So that is why I'm so, so adamant. I know how terrible it is when someone tells me, oh, what are you so worried about? Because I've been there. I understand what happens when you try to entertain mutual exclusives. And it is the worst thing possible. It literally is the worst thing possible. You can't even believe how bad it is. You have no conception of it. So that is why I'm so, so adamant and working so hard to try and be helpful at this time, having the experience and the knowledge of this, and being an advocate for don't entertain mutual exclusives. If you're on the spiritual path, you've been on the spiritual path, it is time for you right now to commit and get a hold of those who have changed their perception and say, this is my lifeline. This is my life. We need a lifeline. We need a life jacket now. We really do. Otherwise, we're going to start trying to entertain both to a stronger degree. And what happens is usually you'll give up the spiritual path at that point. You'll give it up because the stress to accommodate mutual exclusives is too strong. You say, this is going to tear me apart. I've got to decide one or the other. And the overwhelming tide is in that direction is to try to change the staging. The tides now in the Bay Area are extraordinarily low. I saw this low tide, lowest tide I've ever seen. It's unbelievable how low the tide was. My gosh. So there are extreme tides in the world. There are extreme tides, and we're reaching that extreme tide now. And the danger is twofold. One is to quit the spiritual path, because you feel you'd be torn apart if you don't quit it. And the second is to try to maintain the spiritual path, but also accommodate the path of trying to change the staging, mutual exclusive. And that will lead you into depression and worse. So the program is very buggy, but that's okay. No bandwidth. Well, it's still recording. No, it's not. It says it's frozen. Come on. Okay, is it recording now? No. Hello? Testing 1, 2, 3. Are you recording? Well, you never know. You never know with this program, with computers, with technology. They can work sometimes and not work other times. Okay, it seems to be going. Let us make another foray if we can. The importance of this time, the need of a lifeline, the need of a life jacket. If you want to continue on the spiritual path, you literally have to commit. Froze again. You have to commit to changing your perception of the staging. Wow. Can I get a... Anyway, I don't know if this is recording or not. Maybe just the interface is frozen up and it's recording. No available bandwidth. Oh gosh. Still. Wow, unbelievable. I've had a lot of problems with technology. Okay. Well, we're still rolling, amazingly. It'll probably freeze up again here in a second. Maybe it's saying just end the tape at this time. Maybe this is enough. Okay, that's fine. We can get into other stuff at this other time. I'm going to work on the lifeline. And what all I can do is try and present a lifeline. Help those who are on the spiritual path stay on the spiritual path as the times come up. And not try to accommodate both positions. Is this sort of now unfreezing? Maybe. Maybe it's unfreezing now. Okay. Maybe I can keep going. This God's plan of salvation is to exchange hypotheticals. That is the plan. That's the plan that works. It's a plan that takes care of the three problems that we have. It's the only plan that works. So, if all of us will accept this at some point. This is a plan, again, where the beauty is undifferentiated, unconditional. Everything is equally flawless and beautiful. There's only one flawless beauty everywhere. Okay, that's it. It's got nothing to do with this stagehand or that stagehand or any of the stagehands at all. Nothing to do with it. It has nothing to do with men or women, with masculine or feminine. Absolutely nothing to do with any of that. So, the plan of changing the staging whispers in our ear at all times. It's whispering in our ear and says, hey, you know, if we flatters us, it tries to flatter us. It says, well, you men, you're really some kind of big lumberjacks, aren't you? Boy, you can really go out there and build the big houses and get all the mine all the coal and get all the oil and the diamonds and gold and build the railroads. Wow, you're big, strong. Wow, you're just something else. Of course, you're working on the staging, aren't you? And then it comes to the women and saying, wow, you women are really something. You're incredibly delicate and beautiful and exquisite, and you can ornament so well, and you're so talented at working on the frame around the picture and making it so beautiful and exquisite, and you're so flawless, and it flatters the women, saying that the feminine is the answer. So it whispers in the, both the masculine and the feminine, and saying, you're the answer, you're the answer, you're the answer. And recently, the last 50 years, all I've heard is that the feminine is the answer. We must embrace the feminine. That is the answer. Why? Because the feminine are super good at ornamentation and embellishment. Very, very good. So in other words, embellishing and ornamenting the stage and wearing the beautiful clothing and the beautiful ornaments and looking, trying to look really beautiful, beautifying the stage. They know how to do all that. And so we have lived in a culture, almost most people that are in the world right now, we have lived in a culture which has basically nonstop propagandized us that the feminine is the answer. They have the answer. We must embrace the feminine. They're the ones who can make this work. And so we must give all our power to the feminine, because they'll make it work. Because all we need to do is get the details of the staging right. See, we think, well, we've got a lot of the staging basics staging right, but the details, we need to get all the little beautiful details right. All the tinsel has to be right. And so the whole thing is now on tinsel town. And there is the problem is that we have been enculturated into somehow thinking that the feminine has something to do with salvation. It has just as much to do with salvation as the masculine does, which is absolutely zero, absolutely nothing to do with it. And it's frozen up again. Oh well. And that is the problem that most of the world faces. We're so enculturated and propagandized and indoctrinated into believing that we need to give the feminine a quote-unquote a chance. What it really means is we need to put them in charge of the finishing touches on the staging that we're working on. Is it still going? It seems to be still going. No bandwidth. I don't know. What can I say? I'm just checking to see. Is this going? Wow. A rocky road, isn't it? Maybe this is showing how rocky the road... This is the rockiest recording I've ever had. About... Now it's about, what? Eight times. No bandwidth. And freezing up. Anyway... We what the ego tells us is the reason why the staging hasn't worked so far is that we've suppressed the feminine. We haven't given them a chance to work on the stage. See, that's the great lie that's been told us, is that we're told, well, the problem is the reason why the staging hasn't worked, why nothing has not shown up, why the whole purpose that we have for the staging hasn't worked, is because the feminine has been suppressed. They were not allowed to give their gifts to the stage, to the staging. And so now all the men are supposed to step back and use all their efforts to help the feminine complete the staging of the stage and empower them and say, yes, dear, whatever you want, I'll do. I'll be a complete slave for you. I'll just give you everything you want, and you decorate the tree, and you know how to make it the decoration right so that the hero will show up. And of course, we want to make all the women are making themselves so beautiful, so the stagehands will up there on the stage saying, look how beautiful we are, trying to attract the hero to show up. So we're trying to beautify all the women of the world. We're trying to get them to be empowered so they give all their gifts to the staging, all this kind of stuff. All this is a total waste of time, completely futile. That is not the path of salvation. The path of salvation has nothing to do with empowering the masculine or empowering the feminine. Absolutely nothing to do with it. It has to do with changing your perception of the staging, which has nothing to do with feminine or masculine. It has to do with the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is not feminine or masculine at all. Okay? It has to, the beauty of the vision of Christ is not masculine or feminine at all. It has nothing to do with it. So, we are in this situation where, again, the indoctrination is so severe that it's very difficult to pull away from the feminine at this point, because we've invested so much in believing that they have the answer, that they are going to, where the world has failed before, it's going to succeed. Where the staging has failed before, it's supposed to succeed now, because we're empowering the feminine to put the finishing touches onto it and to give a welcoming committee to this hero. You know, that we say, well, the hero hasn't showed up because they didn't have the right welcoming committee. But now you have all these beautiful, glamorous goddesses to welcome the hero there. You know, and it's, welcome nothing there. It doesn't work. Absolutely doesn't work. So we need some way to disengage with that. Absolutely have to disengage with that. The feminine is not the answer. The masculine is not the answer. The Holy Spirit is the answer. Vision of Christ is the answer. The happy hypothetical is the answer. The changing perception of the staging is the answer. There is no other answer. And that has nothing to do with feminine or masculine. It has to do with clarity. It has to do with choice. It has to do with truth, reality. It has to do with grace, the Holy Spirit, with blessing. That's what it has to, everything to do with. And so those who have that clarity, those who have accepted the changed perception, those are the ones who know the answer, who know the way. Those are the ones that are helpful. And it doesn't make any difference whether it's a male body or a female body. The stage, it doesn't matter who the stagehand is. It doesn't make no difference. If you get it, you get it. If you've made the exchange, you've made it. If you're clear about it, you're clear about it. If you're helping those who have made the exchange, you're helping those who made the exchange. Nothing to do with male or female whatsoever. Of course, a male stagehand, a female stagehand, both can do it. But it has nothing to do with the masculine nature or the feminine nature. Nothing to do with it whatsoever. And so we've been led down a false path the last 50 some odd years. What's called feminism, of empowering women, empowering the feminine to be successful in this staging, in the purpose of existence, that somehow they're going to succeed where everyone else has failed in the past. Not true. Not true at all. It's the big lie. It's really the big lie. And we have to be somehow helped pass that situation. And it was helpful for me during this big lie to have a female mentor, a female stagehand, who had the vision of Christ constantly her whole life. And then just to see the difference between that and all this whole push of feminism, I was able to say, wow, wait a minute. This one who has a vision of Christ, the vision of the blessing, immaculate blessing, is not pushing feminism, is not pushing feminine nature. In fact, is not even paying any attention to any of that whatsoever. So I said, hey, you know, there's something bogus about feminism. Something that's very bogus is going on. For me, it felt like the big lie. All the entire time I said, wow, this really feels like the big lie. And of course, the whole process was saying, yeah, but if you go along with this, you're going to get sexed up, you're going to get glamorized up, you're going to get loved up, you're going to, all this kind of stuff. You get love bombed by it, you know. That's how we got kind of, you know, the inducements. Just go along with this. Just go along with this. And I said, you know, it feels like the big lie. It feels like the big lie. So I'm very wary of this. Doesn't seem to be on track, because here is a flawless example of God's plan of salvation, and they're not having any emphasis of that whatsoever. None. And completely ignoring it. Okay. So, through being helped that way, I'm able to be in the situation I'm in now, being an advocate for God's plan of salvation, instead of kowtowing to the feminine and saying, whatever you want, I'll do, you know, whatever you need, I'll supply, because I know you're going to succeed where everyone else has failed. No, not doing that. And nobody in this world needs to do that at all, because it's not the way, it doesn't work. And yet the world is severely being pushed in that direction. We're putting all our chips on the table and saying, this is what is going to succeed. We are going to empower the feminine. We're going to make the mother king, the feminine king. We'll put the queen on the throne. In other words, she'll be the one who drives us, tells us what we need to do to complete the staging, to make the staging successful. And of course, there's nothing you can do to make the staging successful. So all of this is simply a waste of time. Nothing more than a total waste of time. And yet, it's also a foray into the deepest, darkest, loneliest valley of death that we have seen in a long, long time. Because as we are so confident in the feminine, that this is going to succeed, we're believing in plausible success. And as we're doing that, we're not paying any attention to the fact that we're walking into our graves. We're not even seeing it. We're all got our attention on the fancy dresses, and we're not paying attention to the fact we're walking into the slaughterhouse. This continues to be incredibly buggy. Unbelievable. Oh my gosh, is it even moving? It's just nonstop saying no bandwidth and freezing up. Good grief. Good grief. Okay, we'll just keep going no matter what happens here. This is amazing. Never seen anything like it. So again, we have our attention on the beautiful dresses, the beautiful bodies, the feminine, and we think that success is going to come, is for sure. We just keep our attention on that, and all the while we're being led into the slaughterhouse. That is literally what's happening, because success from the ultimate standpoint in this purpose is believed to be come through sacrifice, through death. And that is actually what we're being led into. Again, we think we're going towards success because we've been propagandized that the feminine will succeed, that so terrible, terrible trap, the tender trap, as it were. And who can speak out about this? Can female stagehands speak out? Absolutely, absolutely. And they have throughout history, and some have now. Can male stagehands speak out about it? Absolutely they can. Okay, it's not a male-female thing. It's a futility success thing. The blessing, the happy hypothetical is success. The attempt to change the staging is failure. Changing your perception of the staging is success. Trying to change the staging is failure. So it's a success-failure thing. It's not a male-female thing at all. So of course female stagehands can speak up on this. They should. They should be. And male, absolutely, stagehands should be speaking up on this also. It makes no difference. It's what is said, what is pointed to, what is emphasized that is important, not who is doing the emphasizing. The big lie needs to be brought into the open. By everybody should be doing this. Everybody who feels they can should be bringing this big lie out into the open right now. And thereby you're going to be of great service to everybody. Anybody who's bringing this lie out in the open is being of great service to everyone. Saving them time. Delay is the only issue. As you're waiting for what will never happen, what is the only issue? Delay. That's the only issue. The only issue we have is delay. And how do we save time? Save delay. And that is expose the big lie. Say, hey, it's not going to work. This is what works. We're not attacking the dreaming. We're changing the dream. Okay? We're not attacking a hypothetical. We're choosing a new hypothetical. So we're blessing everybody. We're not saying that we are wrong. We're saying that we've been engaged with a futile idea and we need to change the hypothetical. That's all that we're saying. So there's no hatred in this plan at all. No hatred at all, but certainly there's adamancy and a feeling of very great importance. That's different. Very different than hatred. It's not hatred at all. I don't feel any hatred, but I do feel a very sense of adamant that this is very important and vitally important to save a great deal of delay. Because delay is miserable and it enmeshes you in more and more rationalizations of why did I delay so long? Well, and then they rationalize it and get more intense death, more intense death. You go to more and more destructivity and death. The longer you delay, the more desperate you are to succeed, the more you have to pull in death to try to make the staging work and bring the hero onto the stage. The nothing onto the stage, finding nothing. That is the problem. So we don't want to keep delaying. Delay is not a good thing. It leads to, again, worse intensity of death. So you might say I'm anti-delay. I don't like delay. Anti-delay. Pro change your perception of the staging. I'm very pro that. Very much an advocate for that. But I'm not against dreaming, against hypothetical. Not against that at all. I'm saying choose a different hypothetical. Choose a different dream. And then that's a useful dream. Choose a useful dream. Choose a useful hypothetical. Maintain what you've worked, the staging. Just give a different purpose to it. Maintain the staging. Now, don't throw this, don't destroy the staging. Maintain it. Actually, what we're going towards is the destruction of the staging. As it doesn't work, we say, oh, we got to make more death, more destruction. That's what will get nothing there. So we start tearing the world, destroying the world. We're destroying the world already. The world is very much in the throes of destruction. Environment, everything. It's incredible. We've made a mess of it because we're trying. It's a stage. All the world is a stage. It's just simply a stage. We don't have to have the stage that way. We don't have to destroy the stage. We can give a different purpose to the stage. Don't have to destroy the world. Don't have to destroy anything. Don't have to even destroy these bodies. Don't have to. Give a different purpose to the staging. Everything is blessed. Everything is equally blessed. It's a vision. So I have no idea how this video's turned out because the interruptions, unprecedented interruptions to this video. Which may be foreshadowing the unprecedented disruptions that are going to be coming very, very soon to this world. As the staging, the push to get the staging, quote-unquote, right, goes full blast, shifting into overdrive. and we need to get the flat tire so we don't go down that path at all. I'm working on an alternative narrative using Anandamayi Ma, the life of Anandamayi Ma, which was an incredible alternative narrative, really, to the narrative of changing the staging of the world. Someone who's here who absolutely had no interest in changing the staging whatsoever, and simply abided in the vision of Christ, the perfect bliss of undifferentiated beauty, constantly. People would say, how come you're not working to change the world? She goes, what do I need to change? Everything is already completely, totally perfect. And she was serious. What she saw was a complete perfection everywhere at every moment. And she didn't see the slightest need to change anything. So nothing but oneness, this seamless, beautiful, exquisite oneness. She said, all the world is just this beautiful park. That's what she said, how she saw it. It's all just an exquisite garden. And wherever I go, I'm in the garden. Makes no difference. All beautiful to me, equally beautiful. There are all sorts of facets to this beauty. You go here, you go there, etc. Yet it's all the same exquisite beauty. She literally saw that her entire life, no matter where she was, where she happened to be. It was all that way. And people didn't understand. They didn't understand. What in the world? How come you're here, what, to empower feminism? You're here, what, to empower changing the world, better governance? You're here to empower the formation of Indian state? You're here to empower something? What is it you're here to empower? She was here to get us to choose to change our perception of the staging, is what she was here for. And that hasn't been very clearly seen by many, what she was really here for. But that's exactly what she was here for. And the relevancy of Anandamayi Ma right now is extraordinarily relevant to the times we are in. Super relevant. Absolutely crucial to have a flawless example of choosing to change your perception of existence, choosing a different hypothetical, a happy dream, and to showcase that perfectly. That is all relevant, 100% relevant to right now, to the times that we're in. We need an advocate, one that showcased it here recently, because we think, oh, look at the staging now. Look at this incredible staging. This must work. And it would be great if we had someone right now who was also that profound, of having zero desire to change any of the staging at all. She said, I can just leave everything exactly as it is. I have no desire to change anything here. None. And she says, the only reason why I'm here is to showcase this to you. If you don't want me to, I'll just sit in a corner and my body will be a pile of rags, like a frozen statue, and I won't do anything. Because she has zero desire to change anything here. None. And that is the best, that's a perfect advocate. We have zero desire to change anything. That reassures us, hey, that's the ultimate. So we need that type of advocate now. Otherwise, I said, the problems are, we will try to accommodate both paths, which are going in opposite directions, as it were, and they'll tear us apart, and we'll end up with depression, we'll end up suicidal, you'll end up in confused, agitated, you end up not being able to sleep, you'll end up being exhausted and getting unstable, and mental disease, you'll get on pharmaceuticals, the whole nine yards, you'll end up in all that trouble. And I can vouch for the mentoring of these perfect teachers, because I was at one point in that state of total confusion trying to accommodate both. And now I've come out of it thanks to their help. So now I can be an advocate for just one way, just accommodate the happy hypothetical. So I'm a perfect example of how you can be helped, actually, by paying attention to these perfect examples. This perfect showcasing of the happy hypothetical, of the blessing of Christ, the vision of Christ, the blessing of the Holy Spirit, changing your perception of the staging, how being reassured can help you. It doesn't necessarily make you enlightened like that. No, not at all. That, if you don't want that to happen, if it's a little too fearful, it won't happen. I haven't been enlightened yet, but I've gravitated towards it, moving towards it. Gravitated very far towards it. And certainly, gone is the agitation, gone is the confusion. Gone is the inner conflict. Gone is the depression. Gone is all of that, all those troubles that beset me when trying to accommodate both. Those are gone. Gone, 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 which is a seemingly incredible miracle, because most people said I'd never get free of it. I was told by therapists that couldn't be helped, can't get free of it. Lost cause. I was literally given up on by all the therapy of the world. The psychiatrist, the psychologist, all these people said, we don't have anything, you can't be helped, I'm sorry. You're beyond our help. Then I came across these flawless showcases of reassurance in changing your perception of the staging, and that's what worked. That's what worked. Where everything else failed, that's what worked. So I know that works. That's the right direction to go in. Absolutely the right direction to go in. So that's why I'm such an advocate for it, and why I keep telling people, just work your way into it, and don't have the spiritual pride like, oh, I don't need that. I'm on the spiritual path. But as I've said before, during the next phase of existence here, there will be such a collective will to change the staging that almost everyone will be pulled into that. And if you want to stay on the spiritual path, you're going to try to accommodate both of those, and that is going to cause you severe problems, worse problems than you ever could imagine. So have the humility to say, yes, I'm on the spiritual path, but that doesn't mean I'm invulnerable to severe problems. It does not mean that. And you should have a feeling of urgency. Say, I need to get some. I need a lifeline. I want something just in case. Just in case things get too difficult here. Just in case I want something. Just in case. So what I have found in my advocacy in the world is what I found is spiritual pride among people on the spiritual path. They feel like they don't really need much help. They think they can make it on their own. They think that they already have pretty well scoped out, and I have to say they do not recognize just how severe the problems can become. And when I went through these problems, I was shocked by it, absolutely shocked. I couldn't believe it, how bad things got. I was completely stunned by it. So I understand that we don't realize the troubles we can get into in this world by trying to accommodate both ways, which is the worst problem there is. So, and having gone through it, I know the absolute importance of coming across perfect showcases of what we need to do. Showcasing the happy hypothetical. All important. So, for those who are on the spiritual path, I am saying that you, somewhere inside, you have to search for humility. And confidence is a great thing, but so is humility. You can have both. You absolutely can have both. I have both. I still remain humble. I realize, well, I'm still in big trouble. I feel like I'm in very big trouble. At the same time, I'm also very confident that I'm going to succeed. But it takes work, and it takes focus, right focus, and help. It takes help. So, maintain the confidence, but also be wise and tap into the humility. Say, let me get some super help, just in case the collective will of the planet goes toward changing the staging, which I say absolutely is going to do that. Then you need to have something in reserve, something you can really turn to, and it's better to turn to it in advance than wait until it's too late. Get into the lifeboat before the ship sinks. And when the ship sinks, you'll be swimming in an icy ocean. And maybe you'll be pulled into a lifeboat, maybe not. But it'll be very traumatic for you. Whereas if you get into a lifeboat first and get used to the lifeboat, and so when the ship sinks, you can say, oh, well, I'm used to this lifeboat and I'm okay. Now I can go pick up others who are in the icy water. You see, that's how it works. The Titanic is about to sink, meaning we're about to go plunge into the depths of trying to change the staging of the world, that inky, dark, super cold, icy cold depths of darkness. We're about to plunge into that. Now there are some of us who are in lifeboats and are very used to lifeboats, and we're willing and ready to search for those who are in the water, who are swimming around and don't want to sink, and pick them up and pull them out of the water and dry them off and warm them up and help them survive, as it were. So as many as possible, get into the lifeboats. Get into the lifeboats at this time. Start to turn your attention towards being reassured. Those who showcase the happy hypothetical, the overlay, the vision of Christ, the blessing of the Holy Spirit, the happy dream. Those who showcase that perfectly, flawlessly, get your attention there. Doesn't matter whether they're female stagehand or male stagehand. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. As long as they're not emphasizing that at all, one way or the other. As long as they have this, you get this feeling of neutrality, of beyond neutrality, of bliss. As long as the bliss is there, and it doesn't turn into a guy thing or a girly thing or something like that. As long as that's not happening. A clarity thing. Make sure it's a clarity thing that you're involved with. It's a clarity thing, not a guy thing or a girl thing. Clarity thing. And look out for those who put all the attention on the staging. That's a red flag. If you feel there's an inordinate amount of time and effort and money and focus and emphasis on the staging around the so-called reassurer, say, whoa, wait a minute. A little bit of staging, okay. But if you feel there's an inordinate amount of attention on that, that is a super red flag for you. Because again, the emphasis is on changing our perception of all staging. Changing our perception of it. Not changing the staging, changing our perception of it. So, I need to get on with the day and continue to work on some way to get through this impasse in the world. There's an impasse here, and I've not been able to get through it. As far as trying to help the world, there's too much spiritual pride in the world. Too much spiritual pride has been undermined. Too much. Again, as I said, that this whole pushing of the feminine being the answer, is most people on the spiritual path now feel that the way to succeed is to serve the feminine. And they say, well, we don't need to put our attention on something that's perfect because the feminine will make it perfect, as it were. So they're reluctant to stop serving the feminine, because if you do, the feminine get very upset if you don't serve them. Very upset. Say, what are you doing? How come you're not serving me? And you say, no, I've turned my attention to a perfect reassurer. They go, what do you mean? We're the ones who are going to make it perfect. It's not perfect yet. You're supposed to serve us to make it perfect. So I think that's part of the problem that we're having now is we feel we can't really turn to any perfect reassurer because we feel we need to keep serving, empowering the feminine and put all our efforts into that. So the spiritual pride thing has a strong element of that to it also. People are unwilling to break away from that, to disengage from that. I'm very, very aware of that. Because they will be, of course, criticized, like you're giving up, you're worthless. You're not going to get, the hero will never show up for you. You're not going to get the benefits of the hero and all this kind of stuff you get. But you got no choice. You got to decide what you're going to do, which way you're going to go. Are you going to go with clarity, which is not gender-based at all? Are you going to go with bliss, which is not gender-based at all? Are you going to exchange hypotheticals, which is not gender-based? Are you going to choose the blessing of the Holy Spirit, the overlay, the vision of Christ? That's not gender-based, any of that, no. Because that's here right now. It's perfect right now. It's doable right this second. It always will be doable right this second. You don't have to any process at all. This blessing, it was perfect from the very beginning. It was seamless from the very beginning. There's no process involved with it. You don't have to serve a process. You make a choice. And anybody here in this world, any stagehand, can tell you this. That just as long as they're focused on clarity, anyone's capable. We're all capable of doing this, but it has to be adamantly pointing and emphasizing what's the answer. It has to continuously emphasize the answer. It can't get off on all these side trips, I must continually emphasize the answer. And it's super important, again, to emphasize those who have done this. Very important. And especially the flawless examples of this. Flawless examples. Very important to emphasize that. So that we are reassured. We are reassured. So that's not really a side trip. I have a way to do that. I'll do it through videos. Some may say, oh, what a side trip. But there's a way to work into that. There's a way to work into it. There's a way to do it. You have to kind of get interested in saying, hey, you know, I think this is probably going to be very helpful. Very helpful. And it is. It is. It is. I'm an adamant believer in that because I've lived through it. Directly lived through it. All right. I will get going on all that. And I don't know how this video turned out. I have no idea because maybe it froze up maybe 10, 15 times. I don't know. Hopefully it turned out great because it was enjoyable to do it. Okay, very great. That's it for this one.